Great to see you in church today. We're doing church just a little bit differently today. I'm going to show you two videos. I came across this song this week, which is actually remarkable in light of Ebony's communion. For those of you, we don't sit there and collude amongst each other. When Selena's picking songs, she doesn't ask me about different things. When Ebony's doing communion, I don't sit there and speak on this or, you know, highlight that point. We just leave it up to the person who's actually leading. And you know, with my word today, it's just remarkable. I'm speaking about the love of God, but I'm also speaking about the other side of the coin. And so I need a little bit of help today because I'm actually speaking about two sides of a coin. So I'm going to show you two videos, one that show you both sides of the coin of the love of God. I've entitled my sermon today, "We Have to Do Something." We have to do something. Everyone say it with me. We have to do something. And today that's the title of my sermon. So one is a song, and then the girl who sings the song does a little talk. So let's watch it and enjoy it. I'll put the pulpit down.
Whether you're a beggar or a thief, whether you're an angel on their sleeve, whether you are rich or small, whether you have fell or will fall, whether you've been beaten or done the bruising, whether you have lost your way, whether you have doubted me, whether you are dirty or clean, whether you're a sinner, whether you're a saint, I will love you every step of the way. Every step of the way. I will love you every step of the way. I will love you every step of the way. Whether you know lies or speak truth, whether you use or have been used, whether you're an honest man or build your house upon the sand, whether you have full lungs or barely breathing, or on the streets or castle where you're sleeping, whether you think you've run too far, my open hands will show you who you are. Whether you're a sinner, whether you're a saint, I will love you every step of the way.
Seriously, that is my mom, and that is my dad. Yeah, my dad is a manager to a lot of famous, iconic actors and entertainers, and like Jim Morrison, and this is him with Mick Jagger. Please note his baby blue Adidas matching jumpsuit. No. And that is my mom. She was a model and an actress, and this is her on Chips. And yes, she got to make out with Eric Estrada. So, anyway, so just like any other teenager, I wanted to rebel. But my rebellion was a little different from the norm, because I went to Beverly Hills High School and I grew up around the craziness of Hollywood. My rebellion was I wanted to go to youth group. I would literally lie to my parents and say, I'm going to party, I'm going to this party, but I was really going to youth group. And I know, weird. But I also wanted to rebel from the vanity, all the vanity that I saw in the entertainment industry. So it was just the normal thing to do. I grew up acting. And so, for instance, this is a movie poster, a Danny DeVito movie I did a few years ago. I'm the brunette. But that's just my face, but not my body. They cut and pasted my face. They edited it. I didn't even wear that outfit ever. I saw it, and I was like, "Who? I never wore that. I don't know who that is." Anyway, so the rebel in me decided to go around the country, and I started taking thousands of pictures of people holding up signs that said things like this: learning to love my cankles, my cellulite is hot, my acne is sexy, you know, my scar saved my life, my chemo fried hair is beautiful, etc. And people started sending me their pictures, and went on and on and on. I did it for years and years and years. Then I started writing songs about it. Then I made an album about it. Then I started touring and this and that. And, you know, at the merch table, you sell your CDs. And I made T-shirts that said, love your flaws, and little bags that said, love your flaws, and the whole thing. And one day, I was passing through New York, and I was wearing a cool hotel key around my neck. I just put it on my necklace. I thought it looked cool. So I went to a locksmith one day, and I said, hey, can you engrave love your flaws on the key? And while you're at it, I saw these old used keys over here. Hey, can you engrave other inspiring words like hope, strength, love, courage, etc.? So he did, and then I started making them and selling them on tour. And as you can see, I'm a very professional jewelry maker, because those are my cuticle clippers on a plane, an airplane tray, and my tweezers. And very professional. I went to FITM. I didn't go to FITM. But it's Fashion Institute. And anyway, so basically, I started making these necklaces. And every night from the merch table, they would sell out more than my CDs. And I was like, thanks, guys. I'm really glad I just played you all my songs. And, you know, told you my soul and all my issues. And you just bought these freaking key necklaces. Thanks. Great. Okay. So I knew there was something there. So in between each song, I kind of would tie it into the Love Your Flaws. Like, okay, I want you guys to get a key that reminds you that you're special. You're one of a kind. Just like these keys. You know, you might feel old, used, discarded, flawed, just like these keys. So get one. And then I want you to wear it and embrace that word on there until you meet somebody that you feel needs the message on there more than you. And I want you to pay it forward to them. And then come back and write me the story of why you gave it away. So stories started pouring in. Go to this one. So basically, you know, people would write in, I gave my key to somebody who was about to commit suicide. I gave them my key that said courage. And then I gave my fight key to somebody who has cancer. And then that woman gave her fight key to someone else in the cancer ward, etc. Or, you know, it was crazy. So all these stories, they were just coming like crazy, because we just started selling thousands and thousands and thousands of keys. And I could have just left it at that. I could have been like, oh, this is a great business model. I can just settle here and make a website. This will be great. Very positive and cute jewelry. But I knew there was a missing link. I knew I wanted the money to go to charity, but I didn't know what. So I waited. I was like, oh, maybe I could do proceeds of this could go to this. Proceeds of this could go to that. No, it's not right. Waited for the missing link for 6 months. So one day, I was walking down Hollywood Boulevard, leaving church, and I was crying, and I was like, what is the meaning of life? What is the point of all this? I just am bursting with, like, I want to help, I want to change the world, but what can I do? I don't know. And I saw this couple. They were under an umbrella, sitting in the rain, holding a sign that said, ugly, broken, hungry. So I went up to them. I was like, why? Why does your sign say that? What's your story? Blah, blah, blah. And I fell in love with them. And I canceled my plans that night. And I said, do you guys want to go to dinner? Let's go to dinner. So we went to dinner. I bought them some wine and beer. And I know maybe that's not necessarily kosher, but I felt great about it. And we had a good time. And I was not thinking about the giving keys at all. And then 2 hours into it, I said to the girl, Sarah, I said, I really like your necklace. And she said, oh, thanks. I like making jewelry on the street. And I was like, this is my aha moment. Do you guys want to be my business partners? And they were like, what? Yeah, what? So then So then the next day, I went to the locksmith and I bought the engraving equipment. It was like $300 and ordered it from, I don't remember. And then I went to Pep Boys and bought hammers. And then we started meeting up in alleyways. And it looked like we were doing drug deals because I would pull up in my car and roll down my window, hand them cash, and they would hand me a paper bag full of stuff. And yeah, and then sometimes they would deliver the keys in a very creative fashion like this. Like that was actually an old used microwavable package. On the other side was macaroni and cheese. And they were very creative because they cut little slits. You can't really see the picture. They cut slits at the top so they wouldn't get tangled. So, and that was actually, those were for, it was a wrap party of a show that I was doing for all the actors. And I brought that into this like swanky place. Like, it kind of smelt a little bit, but it was okay. I was like, these people made, never mind, they're just necklaces. Anyway, so then we couldn't keep up with the orders. We got into all these swanky stores, like Fred Siegel and this and this and this. We were selling thousands. It was crazy. We were all freaking out. I was like, let's hire more friends and let's go to the projects and Skid Row. And it was crazy for a little bit there. But then I found out about the United Way, and we partnered up with them and the Transitional Home Path. And we started hiring people from there. And I didn't even say, little by little, they started saving enough money, Rob and Sarah, to stay in a motel. Then little by little, started taking GED classes. Then they got their own apartment. And then Rob, he ended up getting 98 and 99 on his GED, which was incredible. And he was raised on the street. His parents still live under a bridge in San Diego. And it was like so interesting to see that there was literal gold inside of these people. And sometimes they just needed a little oomph. And it was crazy to see what came out. And so then we ended up hiring 10 people at one point, 10 people that were trying to transition out of homelessness. And 5 of them got completely off the street in their own apartments and everything, just from engraving keys. And some of them we'd pay hourly. Some of them we would pay per key, per, you know, word, per this and that. So then this is Jeff and Norma. They actually met by pounding out the keys, and they fell in love, and now they're engaged. No big deal. Just, I love them. I know this is awkward. I just want to stare at them right now on the screen. Anyway, back to what I'm talking about. So my encouragement to you all today is this. Keep your eyes open to all the needs you see around you. They're all over the place. This is a quote from Mother Teresa that I just found this morning. I wrote on my hand. Do not wait for leaders. Do it alone, person to person. It's very simple. It could be as simple as you see somebody that's hungry, get them some food. If you see somebody that's cold, give them your blanket. I'm sure you have a bunch just sitting in your closet. And yeah, it's very simple, but don't do it because you're trying to come up with an innovative new organization, or I want to become a social entrepreneur, so I'm going to become passionate about this, or I want to start a nonprofit, or, you know, coming up with this thing. No, I think it needs to be based on just you actually care about humans, and it has to be real and genuine love. I think it's our responsibility as humans to take care of each other. I think it's our duty as humans to care for people when we're weak and broken, and I think that is the key, no pun intended, to growing leaps and crossing over boundaries of social status and prejudice and complacency and narcissism. I think just keep your eyes open. There are locks all around you, and maybe you hold the key to someone else's freedom. Thank you. Thank you.
Powerful stuff, isn't it? So just if you're wondering about the link, the girl who sang the song at the start was the girl who gave the TED Talk. And it impacted me. It stirred me as I saw both of those things and I linked the two together. It was impacting to my spirit. And I believe it holds some of the keys, no pun intended, all right, to our new day that I believe that God is sending us and that God is leading us to. Remember, our word for the year is Luke 1, 78, 79. A new day will dawn upon us because our God is loving and merciful. He will give light to those who live in the dark and death shadow. He will guide us in the way of peace. So a new day is coming. We know that God is loving and merciful, But he's giving us a new day because he wants to bring light to those who live in dark and death shadows. And that just stirs me because those two videos really show me those two things. Here's someone who understands the love of God, but the love of God doesn't just cause them to sit back in their seat, but the love of God causes them to have to get out there and bring that light and bring that love to whoever is across their paths. And I would hope that as a Christian, that that's what my attitude would be as I live life. Now, Caitlin sings a song about God's love. Whether we're a sinner or a saint, God loves us and be with us every step of the way. Now, that's actually pretty confronting because we like to categorize people. We want to decide whether someone is a sinner or a saint and then decide whether they are kind of like worthy of God's love. There's a line in the song that says something like, whether you got used or whether you're the user, whether you've been abused or whether you're the abuser, God still loves you every step of the way. Now, that is confronting. Are you sure you really believe that? And I actually believe that that shows us the difference between man's love and God's love. God doesn't categorize his love. We categorize his love. And I know very much for a fact that it's in my heart, and I would love to have the love of God that he has, but I sometimes don't. You know, I remember watching an interview with Ted Bundy. Ted Bundy was a notorious serial killer who killed a whole many girls, and it was just horrific and horrible and terrible what he did. And I remember listening to an interview with him where he talked about how he came to Christ, how he was sorry for what he had done. He ended up being executed for his crimes. But I just remember thinking, like, I don't know God. I don't know if I can love that. I don't know if I can be happy that Ted Bundy's going to be in heaven and that some of the girls that he killed are going to be in hell. And I don't know whether I'm good with that. I don't know whether I'm okay with that because my love has a stop. I just don't know about that. And to this day, I would love to tell you I can love and understand, but I just don't because I do not have God's love. God's love is like that. It is encompassing. He loves each and every person. It shows me how far I've got to go to understand and fathom God's love and the indescribable depth and breadth of what Jesus actually did for us on the cross. The song challenges me, and it challenges me because I think, how can God love everyone? There are people who I think they don't deserve God's love. There are people who have done terrible things to each other. If you do any reading of history, you will see some horrific things that people have done to each other. There are people sitting in this room who have had terrible things done to you. Horrible things done to you that there's no explanation for, there's no justification for. And for me to look you in the eye and say, well, you just got to love that person, if you just got to love them, you just got to love the person that abused you, who hurt you, who did all those terrible things. That's a harsh reality. That's a hard thing for me to have to tell you to do. It's a difficult truth. Yet right down deep in my spirit, I know that it's true. I know that that's the truth, that God loves people, whether they're a sinner or whether they're a saint. God, in his magnificence, can and does love everyone. Now, the key to it really is this. It's forgiveness. God has chosen to forgive. God forgives. God forgives us. So we have to be okay with the fact that he'll forgive someone else. See, we have levels. We go, well, if you do up to this part, then we'll forgive you. But if you go over that line, then that can't be forgiven. That's terrible. That's a horrible thing. That's just can't be forgiven. But if you think about it, if God has levels, then what Jesus did on the cross for us is actually mute. All it does is just moves the line. Before, you weren't allowed to do up to here, and then you would be in trouble. But now we've just moved the line. And so now you can do up to here before you get in trouble. Where God says, no, I forgive all sin. And so to forgive sets us free and shows and declares the love of God. See, sin is sin is sin is sin. So God forgives all sin. I want you to all read this scripture, which actually Ebony brought out today. Let's read it together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. As the song says, we just need to give it to him. We just need to give it to Jesus. We just need to give ourselves to God. So where am I going with this? And I want you to stay with me. This girl, who we just heard the song and spoke the talk, this girl from a privileged upbringing starts seeing the futility in greed and the vanity, and instead starts to see people, starts to see individuals, and she starts to see and understand that people aren't perfect, that people don't always get it right, that people make dumb and poor decisions at times. And her response is, I've got to do something about it. I have to do something. She can't idly sit by and just watch without doing something. So she does something. She makes keys, and she ends up with those keys getting homeless people off the streets. What an incredible, incredible story. And this is the crux. For us to see a new day, for us to ride into our future, to ride the wave that God is sending us, for us to be the emerged church that God wants us to be, we have to do something. There it is. Nice and big. Well done, Jacinta. Nice and big. God's kingdom is not about us sitting down, luxuriating in our blessings. No, we, like Esther, are born for such a time as this. When God saved you, he had someone else in mind. Now I'm going to read to you some tough scriptures. So if you don't want to hear these, close your eyes, stick your finger in your ears, because once you hear them, you got to do something about them. So I'm ready. Close your eyes, put your fingers in your ears. Ready. James 4, verse 17. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin. Just let that settle. That's scary, isn't it? To know and have the ability to do what is right and then decide not to do it, that is sin. It's burying your talents. It's sitting there and saying, I may have gifts, I may have abilities, but I want to use them for myself. I don't want to use them for someone else. And it's an anathema to God. It's something that doesn't please God's heart. James 2, verse 15 to 17. If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed, be filled, I'll pray for you, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? Sometimes we need to be heavenly minded so we can actually help people here on the earth. that we can actually put skin on God's love and actually help them, actually do something for them. I'm being tough today. I'm being intentionally tough today because I want you to understand that with God's love, with that love that accepts everyone, comes responsibility, comes action to that. You know, my pastor's blog this week was about the Good Samaritan. And Jesus is asked by a religious teacher who's actually trying to trap him. And he says, what must I do to gain eternal life? And he goes, love the Lord your God with all your might and love your neighbor as yourself. So he gets it put right back on his own kind of like feet. You got to actually do something here. And so to be smart, he goes, well, who's my neighbor? And this got a little bit miscommunicated in my blog, and I didn't mean it like this. But God said, well, who's my neighbor? And he tells the story, Jesus tells the story of the Good Samaritan. There's a certain man going down Jericho. He's beaten by robbers. Two religious people walk past him. They kind of make out they don't see him because of all the different things that might cause them to do. Then a Samaritan, and Jesus knew what he was talking about because the Jews have nothing to do with Samaritans. The Samaritan, he's not of the faith. The Samaritan comes along, sees the need, picks up the guy, takes him to a place, bandages his wounds, and then pays for his ongoing care, comes back and sees that things are done. So he follows up as well on his kind act and what his act is. And so he goes, who is the neighbor? Was it those religious guys who walked past, or was it the one who actually did something? And so my pastor's blog was essentially, you know, we got to actually do something sometimes. We got to go out and against our own comfortability, which I know is not a word, but it is a word at Emerge Church, right? So against our own comfortability, do something to help someone else. Now, my blog was essentially like, we're brothers and sisters. We got to do the family. I look after my family, but we also got to look for people outside of the family. Jesus didn't say, my brothers and sisters. I mean, we have to do that. That's what the James scripture is saying. If a brother or sister is poorly clothed. But Jesus brought it even deeper and said, not just your family. Makes sense to look after the family. If I help people here in the church, that's excellent. And we should do that. And we should do at least the things that we're doing for our neighbor. But we've also got to look out there. We've also got to look out at the people that have yet to come in to the family. We have to do something. You know, I heard, you know, someone commented on the pastor's blog and said, you know, there have been times when I got some difficulties and people have just said to me, yeah, I'll pray for you, darling. I'll pray for you, dear. But she didn't need that. She needed someone to get alongside and help her. And so if you are going to say to someone you're willing to pray for them, I want to ask you, is there another step that you're willing to do? Is there something else that you can add to that so you can actually put skin? Now, you can't do that with every need and everything that you see, but there are going to come things that you see that God wants you to do something about. See, it's good to be blessed. I want to be blessed. I will preach sermons about you being blessed, about following the ways of God, about being prosperous when you follow your Maker's instructions. It only makes sense. But it's great for God to meet our need. But that blessing should just put us in a place where we can bless other people. Faith without works is dead. In the words of Martin Luther, we are saved by faith alone, but faith is never alone. If you say you love me, there are always actions that prove that. If we say we love God, there should always be actions that show that and that say that. For Emerge Church to become the church that God intends, we have to do something. This is the weird thing, and it's also the challenge. And this is what I felt the Holy Spirit show me about the next wave. And this is why I believe it's important. I actually don't think that it's going to be Emerge Church creating these big programs and these big things that touch the community and do that. We'll always do things within the community, but I don't actually think it's going to be great community engagement programs that we're going to be known for. That we as a kind of organization go out and meet these particular needs that come across. See, many churches have big organizations and big things that do that, and they have various levels of success. They build bridges into the community, but a lot of times those bridges are essentially one-way traffic, right? We of the church go out there and we minister to the needs, and so we should, but there's no one coming back. And if someone is helped but not actually shown Christ, though it may help them at a moment and is good, we really want to point them to Jesus. And we want to point them to a place where not only do we just feed them for one meal, but we feed their spirit and make sure that their eternity is right. Right? So the church reaches out to the community sometimes, but sometimes the community doesn't want to reach back into the church. So this is what I feel God showed me. This is what I feel. I believe that God is going to use us as individuals. That people will come to Christ one by one. That each of us will be evangelists. That through love and by doing something and not by walking past the need, we will see people come to Christ. And if you think about this, if I send a group, I make up a group, we're going to do this. And so we send out that group. Now that group helps in that area. That group does something in that area. That group can be used in that area, and it's wonderful and excellent. But if I can send out the whole church into your area, how many areas am I affecting? You think about the areas of life that are just represented in this room alone today. There's schools, there's universities, there's workplaces, there's factories, there's offices, there's all sorts of families, there's all sorts of connections with people who are in all sorts of positions. We would touch many people as individuals. So if I can stir you to go out and meet the need that you see, then we're going somewhere. We're actually achieving something and doing something. We are doing something with the love of God that's been shown to us. And so I want to stir you. This week, I know that God will give and show you a need. That's what I've been praying for. God will show you a need that's going to be uncomfortable for you to do something about. It won't be easy. There's a sacrifice involved in meeting that need. I don't want to start suggesting different things, right? But he's going to put that and make that happen. Because he's going to sit there and say, are you willing to do what I'm asking you to do? He doesn't need us to create an organization that's going to help this need or do that need or meet that need. He's going to sit and say, I'm going to put that person there. I'm going to put that person there. I'm going to use that person over here. And I'm going to need one by one by one by one. And over the years, every Sunday, we'll start to see one person give their life to Christ. And then another person, life by Christ. Another person, life to Christ. You know, I was just at work and this person helped me. I was just at my neighbor. This person did this for me. I was just here. This person went the extra mile for me. And their testimony of God's love and of being Christ in that place is going to be something that's going to do something. We have to do something. I want the band to come. God is going to show us needs. Don't look past them. Don't look past them. You know, I've recently been encouraged as I've spoken to Mark Bromley, who's a good friend of mine, and he's about to do a great apologetics course. But he's been stirring me with stories of late where he just walked around and he said, God, show me someone I can speak to. Show me someone that I can just share the love of God with. And he'll be on his walk, he'll be somewhere. And then it was just some God will put his hand, or just you know, say, that person over there. And he's been able to minister to needs. You know, just talk, not be a crazy Bible basher kind of person, but just, how's it going? What's going on? Told me the other day, this lady had cancer. He didn't know it when he went and spoke to her, but he's able just to pray with her. He's able just to help her and encourage her and point her to Jesus. This week, ask God, show me God. Show me, yes, might cost you something. Yes, might be some effort. There might be some resource. Might be some time. But just do it. Do something. Paul had this attitude. He was with the Thessalonians. But we were gentle among you, like a nursing mother taking care of her own children. If you got a young kid today and a kid starts crying at 2 a.m, you sit and go, well, I want to sleep now, right? I'm not going to go look after that child. But a nursing mother, they go out and look after that child. They go out and help that child. They put the benefit and they put the comfort of the child as their priority. That's what I'm asking you to do. Let the love of God that's so encompassing, let the love of God that is so deep, that is so wide, that is so inclusive, let the love of God cause you to look at people's needs and just say, what can I do? What can I do? I want you to close your eyes. Father, I pray. I just pray right now. Let us see needs. Father, banish a selfish, self-centered Christianity away. Father, let Emerge Church be about the people, about people. Meeting needs, helping, getting alongside. Father, challenge us even this week with circumstances, oh God, to go the extra mile, to do something, oh God. Father, I pray, let us look after brother, sister. Let us look after neighbor. And Father, let it result in many, many, many people finding Christ and knowing Jesus. Maybe you're in this place and you've never connected with God. You've never connected with Jesus. Jesus loves you. It's from the beginning to the end of this meeting. It's just been there. No collusion between any of us. God's telling you He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. He doesn't judge you. He doesn't condemn you. He accepts you. And He says, come on, give it all to me. Give it all to me. And if you haven't given your life to Jesus, if you haven't trusted Him with your future, I want to pray with you. If that's you in this place, could you please raise a hand? I want to pray with you. Just raise a hand so I can see it and I'll pray with you. Thank you. One lady has put up her hand. Anyone else as I look over? Gentlemen over the back, put up their hand. Anyone else as I look over the meeting? Anyone here at all? Father, you see those two people that have raised their hand. Father, I pray, take them at their word. Father, lead them and guide them. Let them know your presence. Father, I honor you and bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, we have to do something. Thank you.